All right. Here we go. It is a new day. We have a new hard drive. We have a new router. We have a new modem. Hopefully that means no new gremlins, right? Good morning, Multiverse.
Live from our studios in Kansas City, this is Sci-Fi for Me TV.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. It is Groundhog Day, February the 2nd. For those of you who are paying attention, Punxsutawney Phil has not seen his shadow today, which means, according to legend, early spring. Hopefully the gremlins have made plans to take a vacation. We do appreciate those of you who have stuck with us over the last few weeks as we get our hands wrapped around all of the technology problems that we've been having. We do conquer those problems, then we have new problems. It's all part of the process, right? This is a learning curve. We aim to get better, and every week we get just a little bit better, hopefully. And you're sticking around for that, and we do appreciate it. Now, wanted to remind you this hour is brought to you in part by superherostuff.com. You can go there and check out all of the new merchandise that they just dropped for Valentine's Day, including a couple of Thanos Valentine's shirts. And when you go to conclude your order, you can enter the code SciFiForMe10 at checkout, and you will get 10% off your order. Now, this can be combined with sale prices. If you're using another discount code, there's only one field for a discount code, so use SciFiForMe10 in the discount code, and you'll get 10% off your order at checkout. All right, now, here we go. And now it's time for our weekly update on the events list. We keep adding, we keep taking away a few, putting all of the events on there that we can find over the internet. And of course, any that you submit to us. Mindy Inlow is here in studio to talk about the latest additions to our conventions list. How are you this morning?
I am good. I'm awake. I am here.
That's a step in the right direction, I would say.
Definitely, especially on a Saturday morning, but it's warm at least.
Yeah, that's all relative. All right, so what have we added this week? We've got a number of events that we've put on this list.
Yeah, I've had a busy week adding, and let me go down for the let you know what I've done. First up is Ronin Expo in Los Angeles, California. OMG Con in Owensboro, Kentucky, Hickory Con in Hickory, North Carolina, Gillette Public Library's Star Wars Day in Gillette, Illinois, Van Isle Comic Cons in Sydney, British Columbia, Canada, Anime Con in Rotterdam, Netherlands, A2 CAF in Ann Arbor, Michigan, V. Mai Kai in Florsheim und Main in Germany, Ocala Comic-Con in Ocala, Florida, Comic-Con Ireland in Dublin, Ireland, Wisconsin Comic Convention, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Savannah Mega Comic-Con in Savannah, Georgia. We have Days of the Dead in Las Vegas, Nevada, Days of the Dead in Louisville, Kentucky, and finally, Furry in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada.
For a total this week so far
of 1,411.
Now, the thing about this list is it keeps changing both up and down. You have conventions that we add and conventions that we take away because we have a number of events that either they don't have dates or you know, they've shut down, they've closed, sorry, this was our last, you know, hurrah, how do you do, and out the door.
Mm-hmm.
Is it getting any easier at this point? Because we've exhausted a lot of lists.
Yes.
Is it getting more difficult or easier one way or the other to find those events that we haven't got on our list yet?
Well, when I do find new lists to go through, it's definitely becoming quicker because a lot of the events that they are listing, we already have on our calendar. So it's very much just side by side, us versus them. So that's been good. Well, it's easier there. It is become a little bit slower on adding new events because our list just keeps growing and growing and growing. So, you know, at that point, you know, it is what it is. And then when I do have to go through and clean up some of the events and make the number go down, there's a little part of me that's very sad because, well, one, yes, on the more vanity side, our number is shrinking a little bit. But at the same time, reading some of the stories on why some of the events have to stop.
And now it's time for our weekly update on the events list. We keep adding, we keep taking away a few, putting all of the events on there that we can find over the internet. Of course, any that you submit to us. Mindy Inlow is here in studio to talk about the latest additions to our conventions list. How are you this morning?
I am good. I'm awake. I am here.
That's a step in the right direction, I would say.
Definitely, especially on a Saturday morning, but it's warm at least.
Yeah, that's all relative. All right, so what have we added this week? We've got a number of events that we've put on this list.
Yeah, I've had a busy week adding, and let me go down for the let you know what I've done. First up is Ronin Expo in Los Angeles, California. OMG Con in Owensboro, Kentucky, Hickory Con in Hickory, North Carolina, Gillette Public Library's Star Wars Day in Gillette, Illinois, Van Isle Comic Cons in Sydney, British Columbia, Canada, Anime Con in Rotterdam, Netherlands, A2 CAF in Ann Arbor, Michigan, V Mai Kai in Florsheim und Main in Germany, Ocala Comic Con in Ocala, Florida, Comic Con Ireland in Dublin, Ireland, Wisconsin Comic Convention, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Savannah Mega Comic Con in Savannah, Georgia. We have Days of the Dead in Las Vegas, Nevada, Days of the Dead in Louisville, Kentucky, and finally, Furry in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada.
For a total this week so far
of 1,411.
Now the thing about this list is it keeps changing, both up and down. You have conventions that we add and conventions that we take away because we have a number of events that either they don't have dates or you know, they've shut down, they've closed, sorry, this was our last, you know, hurrah, how do you do, and out the door.
Mm-hmm.
Is it getting any easier at this point? Because we've exhausted a lot of lists.
Yes.
Is it getting more difficult or easier one way or the other to find those events that we haven't got on our list yet?
Well, when I do find new lists to go through, it's definitely becoming quicker because a lot of the events that they are listing, we already have on our calendar. So it's very much just side by side, us versus them. So that's been good. Well, it's easier there. It is become a little bit slower on adding new events because our list just keeps growing and growing and growing. So, you know, at that point, you know, it is what it is. And then when I do have to go through and clean up some of the events and make the number go down, there's a little part of me that's very sad because, well, one, yes, on the more vanity side, our number is shrinking a little bit. But at the same time, reading some of the stories on why some of the events have to stop can be a little bit, you know, sad for the fans, sad for the people who are putting on the events on why they can't do it. And you hope when they say, you know, we're going to try maybe in a couple years to come back, you really want to root for them.
All right. So we will have more events that we'll add to the list, of course, next week. And if you would like to submit your event, Mindy, how do we do that? We tell them what?
Well, if you want to submit an event that either you're putting on or you know is going to be happening, send us an email at events@scififorme.com. That is the number 4. We definitely want to make sure that your event makes it on our list.
All right. Mindy Inlow, in this week with that update, and we will do it all again next week. Now this week we got news that Warner Brothers is working on a new film project with Mattel Films, and yes, that's Mattel as in the toy company. This particular project based on the Hot Wheels franchise, and joining us from Los Angeles, Loryn Stone. She is the editor at Toy Wizards. And Loryn, is this a natural progression of the creative impulse into Hollywood? I mean, we've seen a lot of remakes and reboots and sequels and adaptations of books and adaptations of cartoons and comic books. Or is this one of these last grasps, you know, this desperate grab for the next possible franchise that could maybe, hopefully, make some money?
I think there's a lot of layers happening here with Mattel, and I'm trying to think exactly, I'm trying to think where to start, because this is a really interesting topic, and I'm so happy that you came to me with it, because this is a lot of fun for me. So what we have happening here is I definitely see competition between Mattel and Hasbro. That's very, very clear. Mattel lost a lot of money in the stock market when Toys R Us disappeared. So that was their first crash. Then secondly, they recently lost their toy license for the DC, for their DC franchise. The DC, their dolls and action figures have gone to Spin Master, which is another toy company. So they lost that. That's a huge deficit, because that's a phenomenally licensed product that they are no longer going to make any money on. So now I think they, and this is just my prediction, I think they have some legal advice from someone being, hey, you need to take your IPs and you need to start kind of doing more. You need to kind of follow the Hasbro model. The thing with the Hasbro model is Hasbro has toy franchises that they make into media, and then they have pre-existing media that they make into toy franchises. So it's this very easy, organic cycle. And they also, Hasbro has also done things like license their properties out so they'll have Transformers and you'll have the Michael Bay version. You'll have the old 80s cartoon. There's a cartoon, I think it's on Netflix. There's a lot of different versions of Transformers, and that's very smart. Mattel has not had the same kind of luck with their franchises. They've been licensing out Masters of the Universe, which is smart, and like Super 7 is making those reaction dolls, and they're very popular, and it's great, and that's definitely something smart for them to do with their IP, since they bombed it and with that 80s movie with Masters of the Universe. But I think this is a result of some advice. Secondly, last month there was a rumor going around that Hasbro applied for an animated cartoon license trademark for Micro Machines. So there might be a Hasbro Micro Machines cartoon coming, and that could be direct competition with something like Pixar's Cars or Planes. So with that, there's kind of two directions that Mattel can go with a Hot Wheels franchise. Something that has no source material, it's not He-Man, it's not Barbie, there's no world, there's no narrative, there's no story. This is a blank slate of $1 cars. So what can Mattel do with Hot Wheels? We can make it an animated thing, and we can go the Cars, Planes, Thomas the Tank Engine route, which is another Mattel franchise, is Thomas. Or we can Fast and the Furious it. We can turn it into something more adult-oriented, like the Battleship movie that failed. We can turn it into something. But then again, you have to be very careful with these kind of franchises. Not to say that you can't make a movie out of a toy. We've seen it work with comic books. You can make a good story from anywhere, but you just have to be really careful. There's supposedly a Tetris movie that's been in the work for 2 or 3 years. That's probably never going to come. So just because these movies are announced doesn't mean we're actually going to see them through to the finish.
And that raises the other question, though. You mentioned the Transformers movies. Hasbro has announced plans for a shared universe between Transformers, G.I. Joe, Mask, maybe ROM. Could we be looking at something similar to that with Mattel? I mean, not that there's very much in the way of toy lines that could mesh very well together, but, you know, you mentioned cars and planes all living in the same universe. If they're doing something like that, would that be a possible contender against something like Pixar's Cars? Or is this... Does this maybe open up the possibilities of a lot more in the way of CGI things? Because Margot Robbie's attached to the Barbie project, so it's going to be live action. We know that. The cars thing, it seems like Hot Wheels is going to be really, really challenged to do.
And what's interesting about that is, I went through the original article that we posted on Toy Wizards yesterday based on the original article from Variety, which was our source, and it states in the Variety article that the movie's going to be live action. With that in mind, people are now calling CG movies live action. So even if all those cars, I mean, look at the Bumblebee movie. That is called a live action movie. That entire opening scene on Cybertron was animated.
The new live action Lion King is another one of those. Yeah, I think they're using that term live action very loosely at this point.
Exactly. And that, I know, I completely agree with that. And you know, the Lion King is not live action. The Jungle Book was not live action. Those were animated films. Half of Transformers was not live action. That was Roger Rabbit, if you think about it. If you think about it, really, you have humans acting with non-human things, like Sesame Street, like Mystery Science Theater. That's what the new Bumblebee movie was, though that was not a live-action film through and through. So maybe with this Hot Wheels thing, if we're calling movies like Lion King and Jungle Book live-action, and they're completely animated with CG, maybe that's something to consider, too. I don't think Hot Wheels will be live action.
Let me throw this out here, just to put a big monkey wrench in the works. What do you think is the possibility that Warner Brothers might announce a partnership with Skydance Animation as part of this deal? Because we know John Lasseter, who used to be at Pixar, is now going to be the head of animation over at Skydance, and that has been met with some mixed reaction. But if Warner Brothers sits there and say, hey, we're going to develop this brand new Cars-like franchise, and here's the guy who's going to do it, John Lasseter and Skydance, because they've already done it with Pixar already once, what do you think of the possibilities of something like that happening, and would that be a good move?
That's a good point. I mean, it's true that, you know, Warner Brothers in-house animation, from my understanding, they tend to, they do have their own in-house animation. So I'm not sure about that. And then, of course, going to Mattel, I don't know if it'd be advantageous to let so many companies in. I'm no expert in this stuff, so I don't know. But of course, it's the possibility that these kind of movies would be in the works because these companies all want to have these mergers, you know, little merges together. And going back to what you were saying about, having overlapping worlds, much like the Transformers and G.I. Joe, which isn't anything new. That happened forever ago. I just don't know what kind of world something like Hot Wheels would fit in with other Mattel properties. And again, I don't even know if Hot Wheels would fit into its own world. I don't know if there's enough source material there. I know that doesn't directly answer your question about the animation studios, but I just don't know the logistics of it.
Well, and you mentioned the source material, not having a bunch of the things there. There are all of the different play sets, the racetracks and the setups, not just the cars, but all of the different dioramas and things that you could have. Maybe possibly we get scenarios that are based on those, that maybe the first cars involves this giant racetrack very much in the way of Speed Racer, possibly.
I feel like it might be a deep dive. I mean, yes, there's been lots of play sets out there for Hot Wheels. I feel like if they want to cite or have the cars drive on any specific play sets, again, it might be a deep dive. If any of them had any names or anything like that. You know, my kind of wrap up thoughts on something like the Hot Wheels movie is, you know, how do I put this? Like I said before, you can make a good story out of nothing. We've seen with Pirates of the Caribbean that you can make a successful franchise out of a ride. You can make a franchise from a board game, you know, Battleship, even if it fails. You can make movies from video games, although the success of them has been arguable, you know, with all the Mortal Kombat movies and the Street Fighter movies and the Mario movie from the 90s, and there's a Dance Dance Revolution movie supposedly coming that's been in the works for... I first heard of that movie in 2002, and now the news resurfaced again last year. Then I mentioned the Tetris movie that got the green light in 2016. I don't think it's ever coming. So I guess what I'm trying to say here is we can make a successful movie out of very, very little source material if the narrative is tight and the stakes are interesting, if it's a gripping story that pulls you in with you know, characters that you care about and a struggle that intrigues you, you're going to be all right. So, you know, it's, I guess my final thoughts on that is, what can Mattel give us with Hot Wheels that will really draw us in? And I'm not sold off of that.
All right. Well, we will let you have the last word, Loryn Stone at Toy Wizards. And we will also link to the Toy Wizards website, as well as the brand new video blog that you guys have just launched over on Facebook. All of the latest toy news and analysis over there. Loryn Stone, thanks very much for joining us today. And we'll more than likely be getting more of your thoughts on this as things develop.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks very much. We're going to turn my microphone on. There's Gremlin number two. All right, turning to the news of the week. There is a lot of it because, of course, we had the Television Critics Association winter event from this week, CBS and CW going on. But let's start with the International Association of Media Tie-In Writers. They have an award that... They have an award that you probably don't know about. It's called the Scribe Awards, and they've just added a new category for trade collection of comics previously published in single issues. Now, what this is, for those of you who don't know the inside baseball of this, tie-in writers write the books that are set in an established universe, so like Star Trek novels and Star Wars novels and... Transformers comic books and that sort of thing. Well, this new collective, this new category basically says that we're going to take the story arc that's in the single issues of comic books that get collected as a trade paperback. That becomes the category for this new Scribe Award. So it'll be interesting to see what nominations start moving into that category. That was posted to their Facebook group by Jonathan Mayberry. And speaking of the Television Critics Association stuff, we have a number of items from this week. The CW Network renewing 10 shows early, making that announcement this week. Charmed, Legacies, both getting a second season. Black Lightning's coming back. Riverdale, Arrow, Legends of Tomorrow, Flash, Supergirl. No surprise there for any of those. Supernatural gets its 15th season. And CW President Mark Pedowitz has basically said, as long as the boys want to keep doing it, we'll keep doing it. He said it has been a very good lead-in show for a lot of their new programs. And he also said that the 6 nights a week programs that they've got now has been an unqualified success. As you know, this season they added Sunday night to their primetime lineup. Now, last week, we got word about 4 new pilots, including a new adaptation of The Lost Boys, the vampire movie, and a Nancy Drew project. And, of course, we already knew about the pilot that they ordered for Batwoman. And it does seem like the indicators are early and good that it's likely that's going to go to series. And speaking of Black Lightning, the problems that they're having there with executive producer Salim Akil having domestic violence allegations against him, Pedowitz says that's a personal legal issue. It's got nothing to do with the show. And that's pretty much the only comment that he had on that, although he did say that so far there have not been any complaints about behavior on set. Other legal woes in the Walking Dead universe. Now, we know about the lawsuit Frank Darabont has leveled against AMC for profit participation. There's another lawsuit that Robert Kirkman, David Albert, and Gail Ann Hurd have leveled against AMC for profit participation. Now we have a third lawsuit, copyright infringement this time, against Fear the Walking Dead. This is brought by Mel Smith, who is the writer of a comic book called Dead Ahead. He says that Season 2 of Fear the Walking Dead pretty much copies the story arc in his comic book. Zombies at Sea is the idea. Federal Judge Lucy Coe denied the request to dismiss this case, basically saying that the story concepts are not generic enough to warrant dismissal. So that will proceed moving forward. And speaking of The Walking Dead, mid-season is back on February 10th, but the episode will be available for certain people on February 3rd, yes, Super Bowl Sunday. Subscribers to AMC Premiere will be able to see that a week ahead of time. And Robert Kirkman's got another comic book adaptation called Invincible. We've got some casting news. Stephen Yeun, who was Glenn on The Walking Dead, and J.K. Simmons, they have been added to the cast. It's an 8-episode animated series over on Amazon Prime. Sandra Oh also in the cast. Seth Rogen, Mark Hamill, Gray Griffin. You know her as Daphne. Yeun will play the lead. 17-year-old Mark Grayson. His father is the most powerful superhero on the planet. His name is Omni-Man, and of course that's being played by Simmons. And he starts developing powers of his own, and in the process learns some things about his father. That premieres in 2020. Other casting news, Lock and Key, another comic book adaptation, this time the third adaptation. Netflix tried it. We have Fox doing it in 2011. Hulu did a pilot. Now Netflix is going after it. This is a horror fantasy. Darby Stanchfield is going to play Nina Locke, a newly widowed mother of 3 kids. They move back to the family homestead in Massachusetts, and they find that the house has magical keys that give the kids powers. And of course, there's a demon who wants the keys for himself, naturally, because that's what demons do, right? Casting news for Dune. This is the new adaptation from Denis Villeneuve, who directed Blade Runner 2049. Javier Bardem is going to be joining the cast as Stilgar. Now, Stilgar, for those of you who don't know, he leads the tribe of Frenum that aids Paul Atreides out in the desert once he gets banished. There is also a rumor that Oscar Isaac and Zendaya could be in talks to join the cast. There's speculation that Oscar Isaac could play the other nephew of Baron Harkonnen. Dave Bautista, of course, playing the one that we know about so far. Stephen King's The Stand getting ordered to series at CBS All Access. It'll be a 10-episode limited event. Josh Boone and Ben Cavell are writing. Boone will direct. He said this is a project he's been working on for about 5 years now. ABC last did an adaptation of this in 1994 with a four-part miniseries, back when miniseries were a thing. King has said that the scripts for this new adaptation are dynamite. So we'll see what we can see. Of course, you have to pay to see. It's the world we live in now, folks. Studio A, Jeb Robinob's shingle, is going to be doing an adaptation of a book called Undying Love. It's a graphic novel from Tom Coker and Daniel Friedman. It combines Chinese folklore and vampire lore into a story. David Leitch directing. He did Atomic Blonde and Deadpool 2. And we have a date for The Batman. This is the standalone movie that Ben Affleck was going to star in and direct. He's now no longer directing. Matt Reeves is. He's also co-writing. And Affleck is no longer starring in the movie. I guess our days of Batfleck are over. Reeves says that this story is going to be more Dark Knight detective. There's going to be an emphasis on the Batman's detective skills, something that we haven't really seen very much in the movies yet. And he does say that this is not a continuation of the Christopher Nolan trilogy. And we do suspect that he's going to go for a younger Batman. And there is some rumor that he could be adapting The Long Halloween, which was a story arc that ran over 12 issues, detailing a case in Batman's early days. The release date now marked for June 21st, 2021. And there is already social media buzz trying to get Armie Hammer back in the bat suit. As you know, some of you know, he was set to play Batman in George Miller's Justice League Mortal, which ran afoul of writer strikes and other problems, and that never came to be. And finally, How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World. This movie comes out on February 22nd, and it's already tracking. It just dropped on the tracking for pre-sales. It is looking to make 40 to 45 million the first weekend in the U.S. That's a projection. So we'll see how that plays out. And you can find more news over at scififorme.com. And now what we're going to do is I'm going to hit this button here, and hit this button, and now some science.
1984 may have been intended as a warning and not an instruction manual, but don't tell that to certain entities. The City of London announced the testing of facial recognition technology in a new pilot program. They said those not wishing to be scanned would not automatically be considered suspicious. That was a lie. Those who covered their faces passing the cameras were pulled aside for questioning. When one person objected, in rather strong terms, he was fined £90 for swearing. Prisons in the U.S. have been collecting biometric voice data on prisoners without their consent. Hundreds of thousands of people may have had their voice imprints digitized. In many cases, inmates were required to speak certain phrases into a phone or else they would lose their phone privileges. During monitored conversations, those outside the prisons have had their own voices recorded and digitized. Authorities claim that it helps with security monitoring, but civil rights activists claim it violates prisoners' rights. Family Tree DNA, a major genetic testing company which U.S. News and PC World both called the best DNA kit for consumer privacy, became the first private company to voluntarily grant the FBI access to its files. This gives the law enforcement organization the ability to poke around at the genetic data for over 1 million of its customers and, by extension, their relatives. The company's founder and CEO published a statement that it does not violate the company's privacy policy. The FBI can upload and analyze crime scene data, but cannot access individual customers' information without warrant or subpoena. On a bit of a different note, a research team at Columbia University's Neural Acoustic Processing Lab has devised an AI model that would allow people who cannot speak to verbalize through a computer. While vocoder speech synthesis is certainly nothing new, with Stephen Hawking being probably the most well-known user of such technology, this version would analyze brain scans to create speech. It's not intended for actual mind reading, since the scans target the auditory cortex, providing intended speech and not imagined conversation. So far, it's more of a proof of concept, but could lead to overcoming a lot of speech disabilities in the future. A group at MIT has developed a way to power small electronic devices without batteries. The idea of a rectenna, that being an antenna with a rectifier to provide power from radio signals, is not a new idea. But what is different about this is it's one that is not actually bulky. In fact, it's only a few atoms thick. Being so compact, it can be put into a wide variety of devices and generate power from Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and some cellular signals. And finally, two Florida lawmakers, one in the state house and the other in the state senate, are introducing bills that will reduce restrictions on self-driving cars. The bills would allow such vehicles to roam the streets of Florida with no human safety driver. They hope that companies like Uber would be able to develop the technology more easily with fewer restrictions. Not everyone is on board with the proposed measures, since the driving record of autonomous vehicles so far has been less than stellar. That's it for this week. I'm Dan Handley for Sci-Fi for Me TV. 1984 may have been intended as a warning and not a 1984 may have been intended as a warning and not an instruction manual.
Opinions are like, well, not these guys. They're actually nice to each other. The H2O Podcast. New episodes every Saturday at 2 p.m. Only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
There is a new book on its way from Crazy 8 Press. It is an anthology of adventure stories in the tradition of the old pulp magazines of the turn of the century. And joining us to talk about it now, Mr. Robert Greenberger. He is editing said anthology. It is called Thrilling Adventure Yarns. Bob, thanks very much for joining us today. What was the impetus for this kind of anthology? This is not something that you see on the shelf all the time anymore in the bookstores.
No, not really. First of all, thanks for having me, Jason. The pulp magazines really started in the late 1800s. And they were dime magazines, and they were either specific genre stories or multiple genre stories. The writers were paid so cheaply, they had to write by the pound to make a living. So they were fast, they were furious, they were imaginative. And this is where we got Conan the Barbarian by Robert E. Howard, and Tarzan and John Carter by Edgar Rice Burroughs. Lester Dent's Doc Savage, Maxwell Grant, The Shadow. These magazines fueled the imagination at a time where people needed escapist literature. They were particularly popular during the Great Depression because you couldn't afford much else than a dime magazine to entertain yourself for a few hours. These things sold very, very well. So things like The Shadow were twice monthly publications at their peak.
And these are also the what we were called the Penny Dreadfuls at the time, right?
Which is
where the Showtime anthology gets its name from that same style of story.
Absolutely. And because they were so imaginative, most of the best of those characters have stayed in part of pop culture for the last 100 years. My Crazy 8 Press peers and I were steeped in this stuff, reading the paperback reprints from Bantam and Lancer in the 60s and 70s, up through the more recent facsimiles that Anthony Tolan has been doing of the best of the pulp magazines. And every year, Crazy 8 Press does a sampler anthology where we all come together and we pick a theme of one sort or another. And we rotate who gets to edit, and it was my turn. And it occurred to me that this would be a tremendous amount of fun to give back, to go back to the stuff that inspired us and give everybody a chance to write a Penny Dreadful. So once I mentioned it to everybody, they glommed onto it really fast. The last time anybody tried something like this was Michael Chabon back in 2010 with a special edition of McSweeney's magazine. So I guess, you know, he was also inspired in the same way. After everybody signed on, I realized we needed more. So I invited other people, friends of Crazy Eight, to join us on this campaign, one of whom was Will Murray. Will has been writing about the pulp magazines, I don't know, 20, 30 years now. He is officially continuing the adventures of Doc Savage, and he's written Tarzan books and all. One of the other hats he wears is he is the literary agent for the Lester Dent Estate. So after agreeing to write a story for my book, he said, by the way, would you like an unpublished Lester Dent story?
Oh, my. Right.
Pretty much I said, oh, my. He said, sure, how much? And he gave me a price. And I realized that to afford a good cover and a logo and the story, and it'd be nice to pay the writers, it seemed like I wanted to raise the money, and Kickstarter made the most sense. So I did all the grunt work. I mean, this is my first real campaign. So there was a learning curve involved. And we launched nearly 2 weeks ago, by the time we hear this, on Saturday. And I was astounded. We launched on a Sunday night, and in 6 days, I made goal. It was a $4,500 goal. I didn't know there were that many people interested. The velocities caught me by surprise. The first stretch goal was to be able to add stories by Will Murray, Peter David, and Keith R.A. DeCandido. That was a $5,000 stretch goal. We hit that a couple of days later. We're well on our way to our second stretch goal, which is hopefully allowing me to offer an upgrade to a hardcover edition of the book. My real stretch goal that I'd love to get to is the 7,000 stretch goal, where I will have enough money to hire illustrators to do interior illustrations like the old pulp magazines had. So people who have been in Kickstarter campaigns say, oh yeah, you'll get there. You're well on your way. I'm not going to rest on my laurels. I'm going to keep doing this until February 19th when the deadline hits. If I get to 7,000, I will be the happiest man in Maryland, if not the United States, but we'll go from there.
Now, you mentioned the velocity of reaching your goal, not going over the goal. You still have several, you know, lots of days to go on this campaign. And we've seen, both on Kickstarter and Indiegogo, a number of comic book projects that are in this same kind of, we want to make adventure stories, and they've raised quite a bit of money as well. But on the flip side of that, not to get too, you know, into too much of the weeds with controversy, there have recently been criticism of that kind of story, that kind of, you know, two-fisted, real man's man adventure stories as being, you know, behind the times and not in step with the modern era. Is that a concern for you? You guys, when you plan these stories out, are you thinking about those kinds of sensibilities, or is that not an issue? You just want to really get into the same tone and style of those stories from back then?
I think because we are paying an homage to something that was very transformative in its day, I truly believe that the same criticism won't apply to us, because we're doing it with a sense of purpose. We're doing it to tribute, and I think we'll be okay there.
Okay.
But there's a place for those sorts of stories. Don't get me wrong. I mean, you know, it's why Baskin Robbins has 31 flavors. There's something for everybody.
So you've got your authors lined up. You're putting your stories together. What kind of a timetable are we looking at for when this book will be available?
Our annual sampler is always targeted to debut at the Shoreleaf Convention, which is here in Maryland, which is usually the second weekend in July. And we are on target for that. I, you know, specifically set a set of deadlines. And anyone who knows me knows I'm very task-driven, very deadline-oriented. And that means we are on target. My stories are already being written. Everyone's got faith in us. There should be no problem having that book available in print at Shoreleaf. And then the backer copies, since many of the people already bid for a print copy with autographs, we'll have a big autograph party at Shoreleaf, since so many of the authors will be there. and then they'll be shipped out in July on schedule.
You mentioned as part of your stretch goals getting contributors such as Peter David, Keith DeCandido. What authors do you have already contributing to the anthology?
Okay. The Crazy Eight Press team will be Peter David, Michael Jan Friedman, Aaron Rosenberg, Glenn Howman, Mary Fan, me, Russ Colchimiro, Paul Kupperberg. All of us veteran writers at different stages in our careers. And joining us is Jennifer Rosenberg and Kathleen O'Shea David, deeply connected to some of us here. We've got Robert Jashanik, Will Murray, Paige Daniels, Amy Kalinske. Trying to remember all the names. There are about 17 of us, plus Lester Dent.
Now, is this Lester Dent story a previously unpublished Doc Savage story?
Sadly, no. And any leftover Doc Savage material has already been mined by Will in some of his own works. No, this is a World War I aviator story set in Europe, and don't know why it never sold, but it was one of a few that were still left that Will was looking for homes for, so this became the home. And I'm thrilled to have just anything from this man.
Now, earlier you mentioned the longevity of some of these characters that got their start in the pulps, the Shadow being one of them, Doc Savage, Conan the Barbarian, and that sort of thing. Are there characters, are there stories in this collection that could potentially lead to more stories, franchises perhaps, or are all of these one and done?
Not initially, but I do note that several of my writers created pulp characters in the mode of the Green Hornet and the Lone Ranger and the Spider and, you know, characters of that nature. And some I could easily see having continuing adventures. Either the authors will find homes for them elsewhere, or Crazy Eight will do a second anthology, or maybe something using these characters. Peter David's is called Professor Ironheart, his character. Mike Friedman's is I Am the Mask. Easily, these could have further adventures. My own story is a sword and sorcery piece from... it was a concept I had for an anthology I pitched to that I didn't make it into, but I saw the potential in exploring this realm. So here's my first story. If I get good feedback, I might go back to that world and revisit. It's entirely possible. Others, in, out, done. And, you know, it's nice to have that mix.
All right. Well, the book is called Thrilling Adventure Yarns. You can find it still on Kickstarter through February 19th. And we will, of course, put a link to the project in our show notes, as well as a link to Paul Kupperberg's blog entry over at Crazy Eight Press. Bob Greenberger, thanks very much for your time today. Good luck on the book.
Thank you, Jason. I appreciate that.
And don't forget, coming up today at 2 o'clock, we're going to have a brand new episode of the H2O podcast. Mr. Harvey and I will be discussing we know not what yet. And now it's time for weather. So let's push that button and we'll go here again. We are in alphabetical order, just like the school closings. These are for the events, the city's hosting events. Next weekend, that gives you time to plan accordingly your wardrobe and your travel and a manga pop in the Celsius scale because it's in Plymouth, UK. Thursday, a little bit of rain. Friday, cloudy. Saturday, some more rain. Sunday, some more rain. 9 and 10, the highs all week. Anime Crossroads in Indianapolis, Indiana. Rain on Thursday, high of 48. Some snow coming in on Friday, high of 30 with a low rally, no, overnight low, I do speak English, of 20 degrees. Saturday, partly cloudy, and cloudy on Sunday, high getting up almost to 40 for the weekend. Big Lick Comic-Con in Roanoke, Virginia, 15 for a high on Thursday, and a little bit of rain. Clouds 16 on Friday with an overnight low of zero. And this, folks, is in the Fahrenheit scale. This is going to be cold. Saturday, partly cloudy with a high of 9, overnight low minus 1, getting back up to 7 on Sunday with cloudy skies. Sierra Vista, Arizona, the C4 convention. Partly cloudy on Thursday with a high of 11, overnight low in minus 1. 15 on Friday, 17 on Saturday, partly cloudy both days. Rain coming in on Sunday with a high of 16. Chapel Hill Mall Comic Con in Akron, Ohio. Rain on Thursday with a high of 8. A wintry mix on Friday with a high of 3. Overnight low minus 7 and minus 7 again on Saturday for their low. High of minus 2. Partly cloudy and cloudy over the weekend. Chibi Chibi Con in Olympia, Washington. Cloudy on Thursday, high of 6. Rain moving in on Friday, turning into snow Saturday and Sunday. Single-digit highs all week. And moving to Clifton, New Jersey, the comic show there. Rain Thursday and Friday, mixing some snow in on Saturday, getting down into the single digits for Saturday and Sunday with a high of 2. DuPage Comic Con in Wheaton, Illinois. They're starting with a wintry mix, minus 1 on Thursday. Look at that overnight low on Thursday and Friday, minus 12, minus 13. Those are the real temperatures, not the wind chills, and they're not centigrade. It's going to be cold in Wheaton, Illinois. Minus 5 for a high on Saturday, partly cloudy and cloudy on Sunday with a minus 2 for a high. East Bay Comic Con in Concord, California. Partly cloudy skies, mostly sunny skies. Going to get some rain on Saturday or Sunday, but their temperatures in the teens all week. The Edwardian Ball in Los Angeles, California. Sunny skies on Thursday, high of 16. Clouds moving in on Friday and Saturday, 16 for the high as well. Sunday, mostly sunny with a high of 17. Overnight lows in the single digits. Farpoint in Hunt Valley, Maryland. Rain on Thursday, cloudy on Friday, rain snow mix on Saturday with a high of 2 as well on Sunday with cloudy skies. Gamerama in Atlanta, Georgia, cloudy on Thursday, rain coming in on Friday, and cloudy skies on Saturday, highs both days 16, 17 for Sunday with scattered showers as well. GenreCon in Guelph, Ontario, Canada. Wintry mix both Thursday and Friday, and we're back into the centigrades. High at minus 3, minus 4. Minus 9 on Saturday with partly cloudy skies. Clouds moving in some more on Sunday with a high of minus 5. KOCon in Daytona Beach, Florida. Partly cloudy skies and 76 on Thursday. Boy, is that an outlier. It's in the 70s, of course, it's Florida. Partly cloudy, 78 on Friday, 72 on Saturday, 74 on Sunday. Kanpai Con in Omaha, Nebraska. Snow and freezing rain on Thursday with a high of 17. Mostly sunny, 19 on Friday. Partly cloudy, 27 on Saturday. Clouds moving in on Sunday with a high of 28. Lehigh Valley Comic Convention in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Rain on Thursday and Friday, snow moving in on Saturday, high of 32, overnight low of 19, 35 for a high on Sunday with cloudy skies. Running Gag in Geneseo, New York, and those of you in Geneseo, New York, I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right. Rain on Thursday, high of 35, snow mixing into the rain for a wintry mix on Friday with high of 38. Saturday, partly cloudy skies, 22, 31 on Sunday, with clouds increasing. The Sci-Fi Ball in Southampton, UK, 9 centigrade for a high on a Thursday, with mostly sunny skies, clouds rolling in the rest of the week. Some rain, scattered showers on Saturday and Sunday, with a high of 10 degrees centigrade. Seishun Con in Atlanta, Georgia. This is cloudy skies Thursday, 23, rain scattered showers on Friday, high of 16, high of 16 on Saturday, more rain on Sunday, high of 17. The Supernatural Official Convention in Seattle, Washington, in the 40s all week, cloudy on Thursday, some snow showers on Friday, clouds starting to break up by the time we get to Sunday, we'll have mostly sunny skies. The Vampire Diaries and Originals official convention in Nashville, Tennessee. Rain on Thursday, high of 70. Clouds on Friday, high of 46. 47 on Saturday, 54, and rain on Sunday. And the Turlock Toy Anime Comic Con in Turlock, California. Sunny skies, 54, partly, mostly sunny on, and 56 on Friday, 57 and on Saturday and Sunday, with rain moving in on Sunday. Uchicon, wintry mix on Thursday, high of 32, Friday 20 with partly cloudy skies, partly cloudy on Saturday, 24, clouds moving in with a high of 30. On Sunday. And finally, ZoloCon in Warminster, Pennsylvania. Rain on Thursday with a high of 44. 56 on Friday with scattered showers. Snow and rain mix on Saturday. High of 35. And Sunday, a high of 37 with cloudy skies.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.
And we do want to thank everybody for joining us over on social media. We have crossed a threshold on Facebook with over 2,000 likes. We do appreciate that. That does give us access to potential press credentials at more events this year. And of course, our goal is to get to more events this year. And we are just that much shy of 800 over on Instagram. So if you wanted to follow us on Instagram, you could get us over the top there and get us to 800 for that. All right, so we are at 57 minutes. We have one more thing. So here's the thing.
I'm Dustin, and here's the thing. Your eyebrows may be making you evil. Do you remember back in your childhood days when all you really wanted to do was hop in a van and tool around the country with a Great Dane solving mysteries? It looked really easy when the mystery machine pulled up to its abandoned theme park or gothic mansion or plantation house and the gang started looking for clues. Velma was always very, very persnickety when it came to clues, but I knew I had it figured out from the minute that the show started. The one with the blackest, evilest eyebrows was the one who they were eventually going to unmask. Unless Don Knotts was there, then sometimes it was Don Knotts. But it got me thinking, how do you tell a villain is a villain? And invariably, it's the eyebrows. A bad guy always has deep, dark-rooted, or bushy brows. So, my suggestion to you is to visit your local threading salon and have that bushiness taken back a little bit. Maybe it'll save your soul.
We'll leave you with a haiku from Dan. At now, at long last, read that book by H.G. Wells, and it's about time. If I can remember to hit all the buttons right. All right, that's going to do it for us. Thanks very much, everyone, for joining us for this hour. We made it through with mostly few mistakes, so we'll try it again next week. Thanks very much for joining us, folks. Good morning.
Copyright 2019 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.